Welcome to worship with Mount Hope Lutheran Church in West Allis. This is the second Sunday after Epiphany. We're blessed that you could join us today for worship, and we're always blessed to be able to bring it to you as well. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose voice is upon the waters, whose mercy is poured out upon all people, whose goodness cascades over all creation.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin, trusting in the abundant grace of God. Holy God,
you search us and know us.
You are acquainted with all our ways.
We confess that our hearts are burdened by sin, our own sins and the broken systems that bind us. We turn inward, failing to follow your outward way of love. We distrust those who are not like us. We exploit the earth and its resources and fail to consider generations to come. Forgive us, gracious God, for all we have done and left undone. Even before the words are on our tongues, you know them. Receive them in your divine mercy. Amen.
How vast is God's grace! Through the power and promise of Christ Jesus, our sins are washed away, and we are claimed as God's own beloved. Indeed, we are forgiven. In the wake of God's forgiveness, we are called to be the beloved community, living out Christ's justice and the Spirit's reconciling peace. Amen.
Amen.
The song we're starting with today is called Blessings. We've done it before in church, although not for a while, and it's a lot more reflective than the songs we typically start our worship with. However, this has been a week of a lot of happenings, our events in the Capitol, our continued battle with COVID, and so it seemed appropriate to start with something a bit reflective. The words to this song talk about praying for blessings and praying for peace and praying for your mighty hand to ease our suffering. So we call on Jesus to relieve our suffering and to pray for peace. And also the chorus, what if your blessings come through raindrops, that we can look for blessings even during this time.
Comfort for family, protection while we see.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray together.
Thanks be to you, Lord Jesus Christ, most merciful Redeemer, for the countless blessings and benefits you give. May we know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day, praising you with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our special music video today is a song called In Need. It's sung by an a cappella choir. They recorded this obviously well before COVID because they're not wearing any masks. They're standing in a circle. The words, again, reflect perhaps the mood of our community, our country right now. So I thought it would be particularly appropriate. I want to read the words to you. In need of grace, in need of love, in need of mercy raining down from high above, in need of strength, in need of peace, in need of things that only you can give to me, in need of Christ, the perfect Lamb, my refuge strong, the great I am. This is my soul, my humble plea. I am your child. I am in need. It's a short video, but I encourage you not only to listen to the words and think about how we call on Jesus when we're in dark times, but watch the faces of the singers as you watch. There's one man in particular that has a tear coming out of the side of his eye, and several people that are quite emotional as they're singing it. So I hope it touches you the way that it did me.
Our first reading is from the first book of Samuel. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel!" And he said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call. Lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call, my son. Lie down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again a third time. He got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." Then the Lord said to Samuel, "See, I am about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of anyone who hears of it tingle. On that day I will fulfill against Eli all I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. For I have told him that I am about to punish his house forever for the iniquity that he knew, because his sons were blaspheming God and he did not restrain them. Therefore I swear to the house of Eli that the iniquities of Eli's house shall not be expiated by sacrifice or offerings forever." Samuel lay there until morning. Then he opened the doors of the house of the Lord, and Samuel was afraid to tell the vision to Eli. But Eli called Samuel and said, "Samuel, my son." He said, "Here I am." Eli said, "What was it he told you? Do not hide it from me. May God do so to you and more also if you hide anything from me, all he told you." So Samuel told him everything and hid nothing from him. And he said, "It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him." As Samuel grew up, the Lord was with him and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel from Dan to Beersheba knew that Samuel was a trustworthy prophet of the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Our second reading today is from the 139th Psalm. "Lord, you have searched me out. O Lord, you have known me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You trace my journeys and my resting places and are acquainted with all my ways. Indeed, there is not a word on my lips, but you, O Lord, know it altogether. You encompass me behind and before and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain to it. For you yourself created my inmost parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I will thank you because I am marvelously made. Your works are wonderful, and I know it well. My body was not hidden from you. While I was being made in secret and woven in the depths of the earth, your eyes beheld my limbs, yet unfinished in the womb. All of them were written in your book. My days were fashioned before they came to be. How deep I find your thoughts, O God. How great is the sum of them. If I were to count them, they would be more in number than the sand. To count them all, my lifespan would need to be like yours." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Words.
The Holy Gospel according to John, the first chapter. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Samuel, Samuel, I'm calling you. Well, poor Samuel didn't have caller ID to let him know who was trying to make contact with him. He didn't know that it was God calling to him. He didn't recognize the divine voice in the night. Philip, I'm calling you. Philip gives the news to Nathanael about his encounter with Jesus. "We have found him about whom Moses and the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael, however, initially has trouble getting past Jesus' small town origins. "Really, Philip, a guy from that podunk town is the one you think the prophets kept talking about?" Doubtful. "Kathy, I'm calling you." Think about your parents calling you as a child, or spouses calling from another room, or the phone ringing. What do they want? Do we respond to those calls or just ignore them and act like we didn't hear or recognize their call? Samuel, who had heard his name called by God a couple times and didn't get it, now coached by Eli, upon hearing his name yet again, responds, "Speak, for your servant is listening." And what does he get? A message from God for Eli that Eli's house will be punished because Eli's sons had blasphemed God. Now Samuel is just a boy whose mother Hannah had been barren. She had promised that if she bore a son, she would dedicate him to God. Samuel had been in Eli's care since he was weaned, an assistant in the temple, somewhat akin to our acolytes, with the exception that he lived at the temple. So Eli is Samuel's boss of sorts. Just what everyone relishes, right? Delivering bad news to the boss about his position. We are told that Samuel lay there the rest of the night, afraid to pass on the message to Eli. Who wouldn't be afraid? Afraid to pass on that message, especially a 12-year-old boy confronting an adult with it. Yet Samuel responds when Eli calls him, "Here I am." With Eli's urging, he passes on God's message. Philip responds to Jesus' call to follow and urges Nathanael to come and see. Nathanael responds to Philip's invitation, perhaps just out of curiosity, and both are soon in the presence and discipleship of Jesus. What about us? Many of us now have caller ID. It tells us who's on the line. We have a choice to take the call or not, depending on who it is or if it's someone that we don't know. I wonder, what if God came up as the caller ID? Do we even expect God will speak to us? That God's word will indeed come to us? Or do we think that we are back in the same time of Samuel and Eli when the word of the Lord was rare and visions were not widespread. Well, God does indeed speak to us if we take the time to listen. During quiet devotional time, prayer, reading scripture, while studying God's word with others, during worship, hearing God's word read, preached, sung. God's speaking, but often we aren't ready and or not willing to respond to your servant with the words, servant, your servant is listening. We're not ready to utter those words because that might open us up to having to act according to God's word and God's will. It might cost us time, effort, resources. We might actually have to do something, even something we don't like. Philip and Nathanael respond to Jesus' call to follow as his disciples. They are with him when he teaches and heals, when he crosses social boundaries and breaks the rules of the religious order, when he calls them to love one another, when his life is threatened and he is arrested. They grieve his death and rejoice in his resurrection. As his disciples, they take part in his ministry through good times and bad. We, who through generations of being the church, call ourselves Christians, Jesus' followers. The word vocation from the Latin vocatio, meaning a call or summons, has long been used to refer to the sacred ministry, religious orders. We often think about those who fill the office of priest or deacon, pastor, as those who have answered the call, those who have callings. We all as Christians have been called. We all have callings. Martin Luther was the first to use vocation in reference to secular offices and occupations as well. Today, the word vocation has become a synonym for profession or job. But behind that term is the notion that every legitimate kind of work or social function is a distinct calling from God, requiring unique God-given gifts, skills, and talents. Martin Luther wrote, "What you do in your house is worth as much as if you did it up in heaven for our Lord God. We should accustom ourselves to think of our position and work as sacred and well-pleasing to God, not on account of the position and work, but on account of the word and faith from which the obedience and work flow." He goes on, "A cobbler, a smith, a farmer, each has the work and office of his trade, and yet they are all alike, consecrated priests and bishops, and everyone, by means of his own work or office, must benefit and serve every other, that in this way many kinds of work may be done for the bodily and spiritual welfare of the community, even as all the members of the body serve one another." And finally, in the Apology of the Augsburg Confession, Luther's friend and collaborator, Philip Melanchthon, wrote, "All people, whatever their calling, should seek perfection, that is, growth in the fear of God, in faith, in love for their neighbor, and in similar spiritual virtues." That's a tall order, isn't it? Especially during such troubling times as we have seen during this last year, during this last week. Yet it is our calling. What happened when folks said yes to God's call, said yes to Jesus? Well, as Samuel grew up, the Lord was with him and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all of Israel, from Dan to Beersheba, knew that Samuel was a trustworthy prophet of the Lord. Because Samuel answered God's call, a difficult one, truly, followed God's will in delivering that tough message, he garnered a reputation as one who was trustworthy and faithful to God. Jesus promised Philip and Nathanael, "You will see greater things than these," referring to Jesus knowing Nathanael before they had ever been formally introduced. Philip and Nathanael's encounter with Jesus would change their lives forever. Jesus' imperative to Philip, "Follow me," changes. Philip's invitation to Nathanael to come and see results in a changed life for Nathanael. He moves from prejudicial skeptic to disciple. It wasn't so much that Jesus had seen him under the fig tree that surprised Nathanael. Rather, it was that Jesus had gotten to his heart, his innermost thoughts and being. Nathanael's like, well, here is a person who knows, understands my dreams, my prayers. He's seen my secret longings and intimate thoughts. He must be the Son of God. Jesus knows us all that well and meets us where we are as who we are. Just as the psalmist wrote, O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. Whatever our deepest need, it is met in and through Christ by God's transformational work in us and through us. The day dedicated to Martin Luther King Jr. is nearly upon us. In his book, Stride Toward Freedom, King shares this. I was ready to give up. With my cup of coffee sitting untouched before me, I tried to think of a way to move out of the picture without appearing a coward. In the state of exhaustion, when my courage had all but gone, I decided to take my problem to God. With my head in my hands, I bowed over the kitchen table and prayed aloud. The words I spoke to God that midnight are still vivid in my memory. I am here taking a stand for what I believe is right, but now I am afraid. The people are looking to me for leadership, and if I stand before them without strength and courage, they too will falter. I am at the end of my powers. I have nothing left. I have come to the point where I can't face it alone. At that moment, I experienced the presence of the divine as I had never experienced God before. It seemed as though I could hear the quiet assurance of an inner voice saying, stand up for justice, stand up for truth, and God will be at your side forever. Almost at once, my fears began to go. My uncertainty disappeared, and I was ready to face anything. We tell the story of God's work, Jesus' work in our lives, with our words, but also by our actions. How we live out our lives as a witness to the good news of Jesus. A witness Martin Luther King exhibited as he continued in his civil rights work. What we are called to do in this moment, as troubling as it is to be faithful to our calling, to be witnesses of Christ for others, to take a stand for what is good, what is right, what is just. As Christians living according to God's will, what we say and do in Jesus' name becomes an invitation for others to come and see, not in a building, but to come and see Jesus. We don't need biblical scholars or noted theologians. We don't need to prove the truth of the Christian faith. We don't even need to persuade others to become Christian. Our calling, our vocation, no matter what our station in life, is as simple as inviting others to come and see. Here is why we follow Jesus. Here's what it means to us and for the world. And by grace, God in Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit, will do the rest. Speak, Lord, for your servants are listening. Amen.
Oh,
guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. For the body of Christ gathered throughout the world, and for all servants of the gospel, that we may provide an example for this troubled world by promoting peace, unity, and acceptance of those who differ from us in race, religion, or sexual orientation. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For police officers and firefighters, for peacekeepers and military personnel, and for the leaders of our government, especially those in our nation's capital and leaders in state capital cities, that they would be kept safe while working to protect our democracy, and that they would be successful in turning back hostile forces. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For a peaceful transition of our presidency this week, and for our country, that we may work together with understanding and a desire to work for the good of all citizens, especially those who are most vulnerable. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For those lacking food or shelter, for those who have lost their jobs, for those who are sick or grieving, and for those who are imprisoned or homebound, that all who suffer may be consoled. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For all those crying out as they have lost family members to COVID, for the healthcare workers who are growing weary after months of working to heal those affected by COVID, for those who are ill, and for all of us as we work to protect ourselves and each other from this virus, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For our congregation, as we search for a new pastor, that we may be led by the Holy Spirit to determine which candidate will align most closely with our mission and with your will, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
In thanksgiving for the saints who have gone before us, that their lives would give us a vision of the gospel in action, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
We take this time to give thanks for the ways that you support us here at Mount Hope. Not just by financial donations, but also by your prayers, your emails, your words of encouragement, your comments on Facebook. We appreciate all of that. We are very, very grateful. For financial donations, you can continue to mail your offerings in, or you can get online on the website, and there are instructions how to sign up for e-giving, or you can donate directly there on the website. But we do thank you, because this ministry is still going on. Even though we're not in the sanctuary, ministry still happens here. Let us pray. O God, receive these gifts as you receive us. Like a mother receives her child with arms open wide, nourish us anew in your tender care, and empower us in faithful service to tend to others with this same love. Through Jesus Christ, our saving grace, who taught us to pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
God, the Creator, strengthen you. Jesus, the Beloved, fill you. And the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, keep you in peace.
Amen. Amen.
bushel, no, I'm gonna let it shine. Hide it under a bushel, no, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Satan blow it out, I'm gonna let it shine. Don't let Satan blow it out, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine,
let it shine. A few announcements. You're welcome to join us for Bible study every Thursday at 1 o'clock via Zoom. The information for that is on our website, as is information for joining us on Sundays for coffee hour at 10:30. This weekend, there will still be a coffee hour on Sunday. However, for the next 2 weekends after that, instead of coffee hour, on January 24th, there will be a budget review meeting where you can get on and preview the budget and ask questions and get clarifications. And then on January 31st at 10:30, there will be a congregational meeting. And so we invite you to join us with that. Information will be going out about how to hook up with all of those Zoom events. Again, we thank you for joining us for worship and for all of your support. Now, go in peace. Be the light of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Have a good week, everyone. Remember, God is with us as we go through these troubled times. Peace be with you all.
Look for the blessings.
Amen.